Hi everyone, I'm Cornelis from Quant Investing and thank you for tuning into my YouTube channel. In this tutorial, I'll be focusing on how to build your first $1,000 or £1,000 portfolio for the long term using passive funds. The choice of passive funds is because they are a good way for first-time investors to achieve diversification at competitive cost and also to gain a greater exposure to thousands of companies and bonds by buying just a few products. By the way, I covered passive funds in my previous video, so please check out the videos from the info card above or via the link below. And you can also like and subscribe for further updates and leave me any questions you may have in the comments below and I'll answer as soon as I can. So let's get straight in. There are a number of decisions to be made before you make your first portfolio, which are first, your investment objectives, secondly, your risk appetite, and third, your time frame. Starting with objectives, as a retail investor, you need to have a clear goal of what you're trying to achieve by investing your money, as this helps you define what type of investments to be considered for your portfolio. For example, are you investing over several decades for a pension pot to draw on when you stop working? Or are you approaching your retirement and need to assess your options now? Is regular income going to be important to you in the future? Or are you just trying to build capital? These are some of the questions you need to answer based on your specific objectives before you set up your portfolio. Next up is understanding your risk appetite and exposure to uncertainty. Uncertainty is best tackled by choosing investments with different returns expectations and different risk profiles. Ideally, you want to be able to smooth out your returns with some investments going up and others falling so you don't have all your eggs in the same basket. And one of the biggest mistakes which beginners make is acting like collectors, buying investments without regards to how they fit or behave in their portfolio. When I first started, I was exactly that type of collector. I was obsessed with bank shares, asset managers, and insurance companies, which constituted over 30% of my first portfolio. It took me a while to realize and appreciate that all of those were financial services firms, and they all had a similar behavioral pattern. So each investment in your portfolio should bring something different, with the ultimate aim being to achieve the highest return with the lowest risk. Next up is trying to understand your time horizon. Measuring performance only makes sense over at least 3 or 5 year long rolling period. So you should have a realistic time frame for your money to work hard for you in the stock market. So now we're clear on our objectives, our risk appetite and timelines. So we're going to go straight into our asset allocation. And this involves deciding what proportion of each asset class, such as equity shares, bonds, commodities or cash will be represented in our portfolio. One way of thinking about this is to divide the assets into two different categories, stability or growth. Adding more stability to a portfolio will usually mean accepting lower growth, so your asset allocation really comes down to your personal preferences and objectives and how much risk you're willing to take and accept over the long term based on your personal financial circumstances. Cash and government bonds provide more stability, whilst on the other hand, equity shares and corporate bonds offer less stability but more growth. One important thing to mention here is the role that reinvesting your income plays in growing your capital and meeting your financial goals. By reinvesting interest received, you are effectively growing your capital in a smarter way because your interest is added to your original capital, which in turn attracts more interest for you. And this is really compounding at its best, which boosts your overall returns. So over time, whether you're reinvesting interest from bonds or dividends from shares, it always pays to reinvest your income over the long time as it makes a huge difference to your returns. With the above said, let's define our parameters for our first $1,000 or £1,000 portfolio as follows. But please feel free to adapt this to your personal circumstances because I'll be using myself as an example in this situation. So my objective is to save for my 3-year-old son's university tuition fees for when he turns 18. So that immediately gives me a 15-year horizon to play with. And given this length of time, which I'm confident will be able to ride the market volatility peaks and troughs, I will make my asset allocation to be in, say, about 90% equities and about 10% bonds, as I want significant growth over this period and a tiny, tiny bit of stability. So for my $1,000 budget, I would have, say, about $900 in shares and the other $100 in bonds. And to minimize my dealing charges and costs, I will start this first portfolio with a maximum of just 5 fund holdings. So let's get straight into the passive fund selection process. And for simplicity, I'll be using exchange-traded funds, ETFs, from iShares platform, which is owned by BlackRock, and this is the world's largest asset manager, as you can see in the chart. There are loads of asset managers who provide ETFs such as Vanguard or State Street and many more, but my preference for iShares is because they have a huge range of products that cover index funds, thematic investing, strategic investing, and many more. This means if you wanted to follow a particular theme or sector, whether it's technology or renewables, growth or income investing, they will have a range of ETF products for you to select from. iShares are the providers of the underlying asset, but you can buy these from your investment platforms which you choose to trade from. I've also opted for ETFs in the portfolio because they represent the cheapest and most liquid way to access the markets and themes. Also, ETFs have the lowest total cost of ownership when combining the fees they charge and the price difference between buying and selling them. So particularly for a new investor who is just getting started with the markets, a more conservative portfolio which holds up to say 30% in bonds would be a good option. But again, this really depends on your objectives and your risk appetite. But in this case, I have taken a more adventurous approach for this portfolio because I do have time on my hands. I do have 15 years to ride the ups and downs of the market, and stocks have historically produced better returns than bonds. So you can certainly take a much more modest approach to suit your specific needs, or more adventurous approach like I've done. This portfolio of 5 ETFs is split between 90% stocks and 10% bonds, but it's also possible to change the weightings to more equities or more bonds if I'm happy to accept the extra risk or lower the risk as required going forward. But by the way, if you're finding value from this video, please subscribe below and ask any questions in the comment section or what more you'd like to see to get the most value from this, and I'll do my best to respond. It really makes me happy to know that you have decided or are considering to build your first portfolio. So really, really good job in getting this far. So well done. In most cases, a good starting point and efficient way of building your portfolio will be to think globally, to get exposure to a broad range of shares by considering one of the products that track the MSCI World Index. And this will give you access to thousands of companies based across the developed world. However, as I'm not looking for exposure to global shares, but for specific global shares which would work very hard for me, grow year on year with double digits, I'm willing to take the extra risk by being even more specific with which global sectors or industries I would like in my portfolio, so as to maximize the growth opportunity over the long term. So for each investment, I have considered them in the context of what extra dimension, growth or exposure they will bring to my portfolio. So based on those considerations, my shortlist for my first $1,000 ETF portfolio from iShares platform looks like this. The first is iShares Core S&P US Growth, which tracks the investment results of an index composed of large and mid-capitalization US equity firms that exhibit growth characteristics. It has a total expense ratio of 0.04%, so a very, very low cost exposure to a broad range of US growth stocks whose earnings are expected to grow at an above average rate relative to the market. The style, which is a combination of growth and value, can be a key driver for returns, as one style can outperform the other for prolonged periods of time, and it will play a key role in my portfolio as it seeks long-term growth, as it has delivered annualized growth of 17% per annum over the last 5 years. It's worth calling out here that past performance is no measure for future performance, but the track record of the growth firms gives me confidence that they will continue to grow over the long term. It has 527 holdings, pays a dividend of 1.25%, which is an additional source of income to help compounding the growth. The second is iShares MSCI Momentum Factor, which seeks to track the performance of an index that measures performance of US large and mid-capitalization stocks exhibiting higher momentum characteristics before fees and expenses. The third is iShares Global Healthcare ETF, which seeks to track the investment results of an index composed of global equities in the healthcare sector. It has exposures to pharmaceuticals, biotechnology, and medical device companies. It also has a total expense ratio of 0.46%, and this is one of the higher cost ETFs in the portfolio, but it has a defensive role to play to weather the storm in uncertain times. It has also delivered an annualized growth of 10% per annum over the last 5 years, one of the lowest as well, but it is expected with such defensive plays as I consider them to be the high quality, cash flow generating and reliable holding to weather the storm in crisis environments. This one has 111 holdings and pays a dividend of 1.4% yield. The fourth is iShares Core Dividend Growth, we seek to track the investment results of an index composed of US equities with a history of consistently growing dividends. It offers low-cost exposure to US stocks focused on dividend growth and access to companies that have a history of sustained dividend growth that are broadly diversified across industries. It has a total expense ratio as well of 0.08% and has delivered an annualized growth of 13% over the last 5 years. It has 418 holdings and pays a dividend of 2.5%. The final ETF in my portfolio is iShares Broad US Dollar High Yield Corporate Bond, which seeks to track the investment results of an index composed of US dollar dominated high yield corporate bonds. So it offers high yield bond market exposure that is broader than any other ETF out there. It is a low cost high yield ETF with a total expense ratio of 0.22% and a dividend yield of staggering 5.2%. And it is used to complement the core fixed income holdings to enhance my portfolio income and performance potential over time. So here we go, the table shows what my $1,000 portfolio could look like. And due to the number of shares I can afford, I have an unequal weighting and end up with some cash which I can reinvest over time once I've saved some more. I'm comfortable that I have the right mix to suit my needs over the long term with growth, with a defensive position in healthcare and regular income and interest payment income in this portfolio. And over time, I can consider adding more specialist funds and shares in the mix as required to be able to boost the overall returns. So when investing in ETFs as we've done here, the percentage weighting in the holdings may not always be the same as you start your portfolio. So you will need to take the best judgment as to which assets you would like to carry a heavier weighting and how you can rebalance the positions over time. So in this case, my largest equity holding is iShares S&P 500 Growth with about 24% after investing. And my lowest equity holding is iShares USM Momentum with a weighting of 15.3%. But I can build on my position over time to achieve a more equal weighting as required to be able to maximize the growth opportunity of my portfolio. Again, this type of ETF portfolio is a good option for a wide range of people, such as those who are just starting out investing and want a cost-efficient way to access the markets, those who want to invest but are too busy or simply don't want the hassle of managing investments on a regular basis, or those who are just disillusioned by active fund managers and therefore want to go down the passive route. It is worth remembering once again that past performance is no guide to future returns. So it is really important that you understand this and you need to do your own research thoroughly before you pick your stocks, as the above portfolio is only an illustrative guide to show you how practical and feasible this can be. But most importantly, to be able to empower you to start your first portfolio, as there's a lot to go after, a lot of growth and opportunity. Or if you're already invested, how can you get better at it based on what opportunity out there is? A good place to start might be to screen for ETFs that have delivered top quartile performance over 1, 2, 3, 5, or 10 year time periods, which suggests that they have generated healthy returns through both buoyant and depressed economic conditions and in an up and down market. One of the criteria which I applied for this portfolio was screening for specific themes with annualized returns of over 10% over 5 years. So you can see how the screening and filtering goes to be able to support you doing yours. So I do hope you now have a better understanding of how to build your $1,000 ETF portfolio. For more beginner-friendly videos on stock investing, please make sure you subscribe to the button below and hit the buzzer to be notified on new videos which I issue every week. My next video in this Investing for Beginners series is about successful investing rules to grow your wealth. So please look out for this. And if you have any questions about what I've spoken about in this video, please let me know in the comments below and I'll be sure to get back to you. Thank you for your time and have a good day. Thank you.